Hi, I'm Lana Kelly, and this is Hudson Valley Art Speak. Thank you for watching today. Today we're going to be talking to Justin Goodhart, who's a photographer, and some of you might know Justin from his photographic work of the Great Swamp and his involvement with the Friends of the Great Swamp, but we're going to be talking about something different today, something new that Justin is doing, and that's night photography.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Justin, for coming today.
Thank you for having me, Lana.
Yeah, how'd you get started doing this night work?
When I started in photography, more seriously, probably about 6 or 7 years ago, I had absolutely no idea about night photography whatsoever. And I ended up on a tour going to Bannerman's Island, just a regular tourism tour out of Newburgh, like lots of people do. And on that tour, the gentleman that was leading it was speaking about a nighttime photography workshop that they hold once a year on Bannerman's Island. And I said, wow, that sounds really interesting. And so I got a hold of him right away and got signed up, and that was about 3 years ago. And I went and spent a night on Bannerman's and had my first formal instruction in photography and specifically in night photography.
Okay, so what do you need if you want to take photographs at night? What are like the basic equipment that you would need to have?
So there's a few things that are, not necessarily super specific to nighttime photography, but that are very important. Obviously, the first thing is the camera that you need. A lot of cameras can do it. Some are just going to be a lot better than others.
Right.
Over time, I've actually invested in camera equipment specifically more for it. To help be able to capture the vision better, because obviously we're working in very, very low light situations.
Right.
So you need a camera that's very sensitive and can absorb a lot of light, much more than a regular kind of basic point and shoot might be able to do. Obviously also we're very long exposures, so we're gonna need a tripod. You definitely can't be hand-holding any of this stuff. So most of my exposures, the shortest they're gonna be in a nighttime might be 15 seconds or so, and anywhere up to well over an hour.
Oh, really?
So, and then also you need a way to trigger that camera without moving it. So I use a wired type remote that I can set a very specific amount of exposure that I want. I could set it to the second.
Okay.
So I could tell it to expose for 1 hour and 17 seconds if I wanted to.
Right. Do you use a light meter to determine how long to expose for?
I do not. I don't use a light meter. Light meters, at least in my experience, haven't been very useful at night. But there's a few tricks that I've picked up along the way, some that I've been taught. One of the most important things I learned that first class I had was exactly that, figuring out how long of an exposure to do, especially when we're talking something that's going to be more than 25 or 30 seconds. If you're waiting an hour to see if it worked, you wasted
a long portion
of the night.
Yeah.
So there's a kind of a little trick where you can set your ISO really, really high, higher than you normally would set. So at 6400, and whatever your exposure is in seconds at 6400 is the same exposure in minutes at ISO 100.
Really?
Yeah, it's a direct correlation. So you can take a 4 second exposure. You don't have to wait too long. You can see if everything kind of looks the way you want it to look. It's going to have a lot of grain. It's not going to be a very nice looking picture.
Right.
But then you can then dial your ISO back down, change it to minutes, and you're going to get essentially the same exact exposure.
Wow, that's great to know.
Yeah.
What ISO do you, is there something that you typically shoot at in ISO, or is it just all over the place?
I have a few kind of standard settings that I'm going to use depending on what I'm trying to capture. So if I'm taking something that's going to be a really long exposure where I'm going to get these stars moving through space or cars moving down a highway or something like that, I'm going to want to shoot at the lowest ISO that I can.
Okay.
So usually at 100 to maybe 200, depending on what the situation is, because you're going to get the highest quality image in that sense.
Right.
If you're trying to stop motion, then I'm going to have to increase my ISO so that then I can reduce my shutter speed. So, like if I'm taking a picture of a starry sky and I don't want the stars to look like streaks and I want them to be little dots, generally somewhere around 30 seconds is the longest that you can go.
Without seeing the star movement.
Correct.
Or the earth movement.
Correct, exactly.
Yeah.
It is actually us moving, not the sky. But yeah, so about 30 seconds. So then my ISO is going to come way up from there.
Okay.
And, it's going to depend on the ambient light and the moonlight and what's exactly going on. but you know, it might be somewhere around ISO 2000 to maybe even up to ISO 5000.
Okay, just thinking about the Bannerman Island pictures, mm-hmm. How dark was it? I mean, was there a moon? Was there mm-hmm. any light?
So my most recent trip to Bannerman in September, it was the first time I was there where we were actually planning around some moonlight. The first two times I was there was under the new moon, so essentially no moon at all.
Right.
So it was very dark. When it's very dark like that, it's great for taking pictures of stars because they're very bright compared to everything else. So they show up very well. They're not getting drowned out by the moonlight. The most recent time I went, it was actually about a 30% moon, so about 30% of full moonlight. But it rose a little bit later. It was after midnight, about 1 or 2 a.m., I think, the moon rose. So we started the night in kind of almost pitch black.
Yeah.
And then as the night went on, we got a little more light. So when you're taking pictures of maybe the structures within the night sky, now they have a little bit more light that I wouldn't have to add with a flashlight, which is a different technique that you can use.
Right.
I actually liked that better.
To have a little bit of light in the sky?
Yeah, because I started with the full dark, so that's what I was used to at first, so I kind of planned a lot of my other shoots around that. And then with a little more experience, with a little bit more moonlight, I decided I liked a little bit, especially.
Yeah. And what about the shots at Joshua Tree?
Yes.
You were out in the desert.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I was in Joshua Tree National Park in California just last week, right before Thanksgiving. And the main purpose of going to Joshua Tree this time, we'd been there before, was to take photographs at night.
So people are seeing that this is new to everybody. Yeah. This is a debut tonight of your photographs.
Yes. Yeah. 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 There's been a couple on Facebook. But that's about it. So, I didn't really get to plan around the moon for this one because it was when we were going to be there for Thanksgiving. There was a small sliver of a moon that rose very late, which was nice when that happened. Most of my shooting, though, was when it was pretty dark.
Yeah.
Which was great for getting wonderful pictures of the stars.
Yeah.
Including the Milky Way. You could see the Milky Way structure even a little bit with your naked
eye. Yeah, the one with the Milky Way is pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. How much does light pollution figure into something like this? I mean, I know you're out in the middle mm-hmm. of nowhere when you're doing something like Joshua Tree, but it must be much more difficult when you're working in a city or a town to get shots like that.
Yeah, and it does make a huge difference. And even Joshua Tree, there's a surprising amount of light pollution.
Yeah.
It can feel remote when you're there, but even LA is not that far away. So when you look in the distance of the cities, even at night, especially when you do a long exposure, it can start to almost look daylight at the horizon or like it's sunrise or sunset, even when it's 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
If you're shooting in the Hudson Valley, like at Bannerman's Island, you are losing a lot of stars to the light pollution.
Right.
Especially depending on which way you're facing.
Right, so right.
Facing towards Newburgh, you lose a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Well, wouldn't it be worse facing toward Manhattan?
It's a little further off.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's kind of balancing those two, I guess. But
Yeah. It surprises me how much detail you get in the foregrounds or say, the cactus structures mm-hmm. and you, even that little motorhome that you stayed in.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's that's trying to figure out that right focal distance. That you're going to get as much as possible in focus. It's pretty complicated, even for me.
Yeah.
I barely even understand it sometimes. It's a little bit of trial and error and doing some of those practice shots that I do to try to kind of figure out my composition. That's part of it, not just the exposure, but the composition of the image. It's trying to find that right balance that you're going to get your foreground and enough clarity that it looks nice and sharp, but also your stars, and that can be very complicated.
Right.
At night, a wide angle lens helps a lot.
Yeah. So. Yeah. So when there was one shot that I was looking at, the one at Ricketts Lake, mm-hmm. where you have the stars, the movement, but it looks like it's
looks like daylight.
The afternoon. Yeah.
Yeah. That was actually shot under a almost full moon. I think the moon was it was the day after the full moon or so it was probably 97 or 98% moonlight.
Yeah.
That was about midnight.
Yeah.
So it was the moon was pretty high in the sky. directly behind me, so it was really illuminating the scene.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing how much light the moon can add.
Yeah.
I was working that night completely without flashlights. I mean, you didn't.
Oh,
you
really?
Could walk around almost like daylight.
Yeah. And I looked at the list that you gave me of the technical details, mm-hmm. and that was the f-stop was 4.5, which says to me that there's not much depth of field at
right.
all. But the depth of field in that picture is amazing.
Yeah, and that's again that there's always that kind of hyperfocal distance, and basically what that means that there's a point at every f-stop at whatever focal length or whatever lens you're using, that from that distance out to infinity is in focus.
Yeah.
There's a few things that affect that. Obviously, the further out that you're focused. So mm-hmm. if I'm focusing on something that's very close to me. That's really hard to do at a small aperture like that.
Yeah.
Or a large aperture, small number, small f-stop, large aperture. If I move that focal distance back, so if I'm focusing on something that's now 30 feet away from me,
yes.
pretty much everything beyond that will be in focus as
right.
well. And so that's kind of where you come into composition and figuring out where that kind of sweet spot is for what you're trying to figure out. So I shoot some stuff at night at f2.8. which is most people consider a really, really shallow depth
yes,
of field.
Yes, yes.
Including that image was shot at f2.8.
Vanderman Island, that shot?
And I think most people that are photographers would be surprised by that.
Yes, I am.
But I was probably about 30 feet away from the structure.
Yeah, interesting. So. Interesting. Now, you've also been doing some city shots?
Yeah, a little bit.
City work?
Yeah, so, I mean, Manhattan especially and, mm-hmm. and Brooklyn. Is a great place to go and get some really interesting scenes and interesting things to photograph at night. Not much for stars.
Yeah, I was just going to say a lot of that would be more structural, though,
yes. Yeah, I like to do a lot with I especially like the bridges and uh-huh. the city skyline and incorporating those, or moving vehicles, whether they're on the street or on the bridge and stuff like that. And kind of where I would maybe have the stars moving, now I have the lights of the vehicles moving.
Right, which you can kind of see in this picture of
a
Grand Central Station.
Yeah.
You can see a taxi.
Yeah, this was
a car.
This was fairly short, I think about 25 seconds.
Uh-huh.
So you can still even see the vehicles. If I extended that to minutes, then they would basically blur away.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Justin, for something like 25, well, do you always put it on a tripod?
Always.
You always?
Always.
Yeah.
There's really no choice. Unless you're going to, rest it on, you could rest it on something.
Right,
guess,
right,
but,
yeah.
But yeah, you can't hand hold it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if somebody wanted to get started in nighttime photography really quickly, because we don't have much time,
sure.
what should they do?
First thing they should do is either do some online reading or some books on about night photography to really get some of the basics. And invest in a good tripod.
Okay.
The most important thing is a good tripod.
Yeah, and a digital DSLR single lens reflex is a must? Or?
Not necessarily a must. There's some really good mirrorless cameras that some people are really using, especially the Sonys are quite well known now for it. But more than your general basic point and shoots, because you have to have that long exposure.
Right, what is a mirrorless camera?
So instead of a DSLR, you look through the lens when you look through the viewfinder.
Yeah.
So there's a mirror that switches back and forth.
Oh, yes.
And
okay.
then mirrorless, you're basically looking at the digital version of it when you look through the viewfinder.
Okay, that's it for us. So, thank you.
Thank you, Anna.
It was great having you here tonight.
Yes, thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome.